Good evening and welcome to Meet Your Candidates, our award-winning program that's been on our TV show since, maybe 35 years, and we're really happy to be here this evening. We'd like to encourage your questions for District 12 and later on this evening the candidates for Stutzman County Commission. We're going to start with candidates for District 12, and I'd like to tell you what the phone number is this evening for your calling questions. It's 252-2400. That's 252-2400. Or you can send us an email at news@kcsitv.com. That's news@kcsitv.com. We're going to start with opening remarks from each of the candidates, and I'm going to start with on my far right with Jessica Hake, which is your left. And Jessica, would you please give us your opening comments?
Sure, that'd be great. Hi, I'm Jessica Hake, running for District 12 House. I would like to thank Chris and CSI Cable for hosting this wonderful event. I'd like to thank my opponents for being here so we can have this discussion. And I'd like to thank you, the viewer, for being here this evening and spending your time with us. North Dakota has a great opportunity in the next legislative session. Education is a primary focus of mine. How many of you have children and grandchildren in school right now? Education is the great equalizer, and it's the greatest investment we can make for the future. Infrastructure is another critical need. How many of you drive on bumpy roads every single day? We need to address the critical infrastructure needs. Finally, property tax reform. How many of you own a home? I've owned a home for the past 3 years, and here in Jamestown, we pay some of the highest property tax in the state. With my professional hands-on experience through my career at North Dakota Farmers Union, I've addressed all three of these issues. And in my job in Senator Conrad's office, I've worked with Republicans and Democrats alike to find sound solutions. I will take that bipartisan effort to Bismarck, and that is why I'm asking for your vote.
Thank you, Jessica. Our next answer will be coming, next opening remark will be coming from Alex Loyson. Alex?
Thank you. Hello, my name is Alex Loyson, candidate for the North Dakota House of Representatives. I would like to thank Chris, the other candidates, and you for your time. I feel fortunate to have been born and raised right here in Jamestown with North Dakota values and work ethic. North Dakota has the lowest unemployment rate in the country and a surplus projected to be over $2 billion. We have been blessed and are living in exciting times right now. We are about to experience the single largest investment in North Dakota's history by Senex Harvest State, just a few miles east of Jamestown. Some may fear the growth and changes it brings to our community. I embrace them. My campaign slogan has been, preserve our past, grow our future. I believe we can improve our quality of life while prospering both financially and culturally from these exciting changes. Don't get me wrong, there will be growing pains, but with the right leadership, they can be managed, and North Dakota can continue to lead the nation. I respectfully ask for your vote and guarantee you I will work tirelessly to represent all the residents of District 12 and help you and your family to an even brighter future.
Thank you. That was Alex Loyson, who's running for the House of Representatives for District 12. Our next next opening statement will be coming from Lyle Hansen. Lyle?
Thanks, Chris, for putting on this forum. I'm Lyle Hansen, candidate for the House of Representatives in North Dakota. It's been a privilege to serve the people of District 12. I've lived in District 12 for many years and have experience as a state legislator. I serve on the Education and the Natural Resources Committee. With this experience, it helps me to put together a part of North Dakota that we all can be proud of. I've always worked with bipartisan agreement, and again, I probably will do it again. I'll stand up for the rights of everybody, and thank you, and I hope to serve the District 12 one more time.
Thank you, Lyle. That was Lyle Hansen running for House of Representatives from District 12. Our next opening statement will be coming from Ken Hall. Ken, would you give us your opening statement, please?
Sure. My name is Ken Hall. I'm a candidate for District 12 House. I'd like to thank KCSI-TV for hosting this event and Chris for moderating it. I've spent most of my life in public service, though this is my first shot at politics. I do not intend to become a career politician. Our great country was founded with the intent that it be governed by citizen legislators, not career politicians. My priorities will be investing in infrastructure, creating good-paying jobs, and improving quality of life. North Dakota is at a crossroads in terms of the future. We need to preserve the open spaces and high-quality environment that we enjoy, and at the same time encourage development so that our children and grandchildren will have greater opportunities than we had to live and work in such a great state. I will work with the willing to achieve these goals. I will also be looking at making sure we have put aside some of our bounty for the future and provided as much tax relief as possible for all of us so we can make our lives better, open businesses, and prosper. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Ken Hall. Now we're going to our candidates for Senate, and we're going to start with John Grabinger.
Good evening. I'd like to thank CSI and Chris for holding this forum, and you, the viewers, for tuning in. The decisions made by our legislators in the next session will definitely have an impact on the continued financial vitality of our state, but also must be effective in addressing the many issues that have been pushed down the road for too long. We must see real action on property tax reform, infrastructure concerns throughout our state, educational funding, whether it be early childhood or all the way through college. We need to elect leaders that will bring ideas and solutions to the table with an emphasis on working with whomever. We need to consider leaders who offer past experience and strong voices that have dealt with very difficult public decisions before. I offer to you, the citizens of District 12, my background of fiscally responsible leadership that has served Jamestown well as one of your council members. I will give you 100% effort as your state senator. I look forward to addressing the many challenges faced by our veterans, senior citizens, small businesses, and others. With your vote, you have the opportunity to elect a trusted community leader. Therefore, I am asking for your vote and support for John Grabinger. Thank you.
Thank you, John. That was John Grabinger, Senate candidate for District 12. Our last but certainly not least is Bernie Satrum, who is running for a Senate from District 12. Bernie, please.
I've been blessed to live in Jamestown for the last 35 years. Like the rest of the people here, I love Jamestown. My professional life has been spent helping groups, churches primarily, and schools, basically work together to get their dreams from the standpoint of having a need, building a vision, putting together a plan, working together, making it happen. I believe that working together, great things can happen. It's been fun to be out on the campaign trail and meet so many of you, hundreds and many, many acquaintances and lots of good friends, and I really appreciate the time that you've taken. We have great needs and we have great opportunities. I think these are extraordinary times, and I'd love to help you to grow a wonderful future together. Thank you.
Thank you, and that was Bernie Satrum, who is running for the Senate from District 12. Just so you know how we're going to do this evening, we have two Senate candidates and four candidates for House. We will be rotating the questions. Each person will have a chance to answer each question, and we are not going to make a distinction. We will tell you who is running for House and Senate, but they will all be answering these questions in the rotation. So the first question is going to go to Lyle Hansen. Is going to start, and the question is, if Obamacare continues after the presidential election, do you feel the program is better run at the federal level or at the state level?
Well, I can give you a short answer. The state can do a better job than probably the federal. We have a limited amount of people or population, and as a result, then I think the state can handle it a lot better.
The next person to answer that question is the Republican candidate for District 12, and that's Ken Hall. And Ken, I will repeat the question for you. If Obamacare continues after the presidential election, do you feel the program is better run at the federal level or at the state level?
Honestly, I don't think it makes any difference. All the calls are going to be made from Washington on Obamacare. So that's what you get.
Okay, thank you very much. Our next answer will be coming from John Grabinger. John, again, better at the state level or at the federal level?
Well, I can look back at our last legislative session, and I think we missed an opportunity there when the federal government, under the Affordable Health Care Act, was requiring states to set up a health exchange, and we had the opportunity to do that in North Dakota and didn't take action and do that. So now the federal government will probably be coming in and doing that, and it will probably cost the state of North Dakota more money to do that. So I would hope we are more proactive on this and as a state, and take the actions that we need to implement it properly.
Thank you. That was John Grabinger, Democrat candidate for the Senate from District 12. Our next candidate to answer is Bernie Satrum, who is also running for the Senate as the Republican candidate. Bernie, do we want Obamacare taken care of by the state or the federal government?
Well, I believe that I believe in local control, so I'm hoping that if it does get enacted, that it will be handled by the state and not the federal government. The more I read about Obamacare, the more concerns that I have regarding its cost and the implications and the taxes and the other issues. So I'm very concerned, but hopefully if we have state control, we can hopefully control things, and hopefully things will be better.
Thank you, Bernie. That was Bernie Satrum, who is running for as a Republican candidate for Senate. And our next question, next answer will be coming from Jessica Hake, who is the Democrat candidate for House in District 12.
Thank you, Chris. I think that the Affordable Care Act would be better run by the state government as opposed to the federal government. The Medicare exchange that we could have set up during the last legislative session, now because they didn't set that up, now the federal government is going to come in and set that up for us as per the law. And I don't think that's the step in the right direction. I think the state government needs to have control over what we do here, because local leaders know more than the federal government would.
Thank you, Jessica. Our next candidate to answer will be Alex Loyson. Alex?
Yeah, I would agree with everything said here under one condition, and that is if the rules and the playing field was fair. Now, you got to keep in mind, the rules have not been written for how these exchanges fully function and work. So I have a few concerns. One is, what are these rules that we're going to have to follow, if we agree to run it at a state level? And the second is, where's the liability to maintain this exchange if it doesn't end up being profitable after the federal government pulls the initial funding from us? So there are some severe concerns that I have with the state picking this up. And I would love to see all the rules put out before making a full decision, but as of right now, I think the federal government can handle that.
Thank you, Alex. That was Alex Loyson, who is a Republican candidate for District 12 House. Our next question, everybody got that one, right? Just making sure here. Our next question has to do with our state surplus, which is rather large. We are in a very wonderful position as far as that goes. But I'm going to start with you, John, and I want to ask you how you would like to see the surplus spent, if you would see it as lowering property taxes or in some other fashion.
Well, it's great that we're in the financial position we are in this state, and the good Lord has blessed us with the oil out there in the West and the coal that is, and even the agriculture that's helped produce this wealth. But what we do with it is very important, and that the next legislature will have an opportunity to do a lot with that. We need to look seriously at the infrastructure concerns, not only out west, but right here in Stutsman County. We've been impacted dramatically from the floods and so forth, and we've got to fix these roads and bridges. Property tax reform has also got to be on the table. I think there's several great proposals out there. I can support several of them if they, whatever the legislature chooses to do. But we've got to treat people fairly, and I think we can do that and bring some real property tax relief to everybody.
Thank you. That was John Grabinger running for the Senate from District 12 as a Democrat. Next answer will be coming from Bernie Satrum, who's running for the Senate from the Republican side.
Well, just as we have a surplus, we also have a surplus of needs, and I think it's probably going to take a little bit of time for some of the dust to settle just to exactly know what all the needs that we have are. Infrastructure is absolutely imperative, and particularly in the western part of the country, we also have that in the eastern part of the country, not only for long-term issues that we've had, like John said, regarding the roads and the sewers and things like that, but we also need to build infrastructure so that we can grow and continue to grow our economy here. So, of course, property tax reform is critical. I'm really excited about a proposal that Dalrymple has, which would provide special assistance to disabled people and seniors. I had a woman, as I was knocking on the door one day, she said, my mom's taxes have gone up, and it's become a choice for her between medication and food and taxes, and something's wrong, very, very wrong with that. What some people may not realize is that if we can help disabled people, if we can help seniors to stay in their homes as long as possible, that's better for their quality of life, and that also ends up saving the taxpayers in the long run. So I'm hoping that we can do that.
Thank you. That was Bernie Satram. Next to answer the question will be Jessica Hake, who is at the far end of the table. Jessica.
Thank you, Chris. I think one of the most critical things that we need to address right now is our infrastructure needs. There are several proposals on the table. The homestead property tax credit is something that I would support, as well as home easements for property tax reform as well. Infrastructure needs, what we can do there is of the state aid distribution fund, 0.4 of 1% of sales tax has been going back to the counties and townships. When that was promised and set up, it was designed to be 0.6 of 1% of sales tax. We can use that to increase the amount that is going back to our local cities, counties, and townships. And we can all do those. And what the most important thing we need to do is get all of the leaders together in a room, come up with a comprehensive, sustainable plan for the future so that we can continue with growth. Great opportunity here with the fertilizer plant moving in so that we can be proactive with our infrastructure rather than reactive.
Thank you, Jessica. Next to answer the question will be Alex Loyson. Alex.
Thank you. There's three things that I believe are the most important with funding with our state surplus. And that would be one, our infrastructure. Again, not only out west, but here at home too, we have several concerns on the streets of Jamestown and in our infrastructure around here. The second is permanent tax relief. Now, I support the continued relief that we have seen in past sessions, but I want to find a permanent solution to property taxes so that we don't continue to be facing this issue again. And the third one is ensuring our education system is functioning at top notch, and investing in them and making sure that our students are really, really getting the best education they can. And fourth, I would love to make sure we improve our quality of life in North Dakota. And by doing that, I believe it's continuing to set funds aside for future investment and generations. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Alex Loyson. Our next answer is Lyle Hansen. Lyle.
Probably the most taxes you pay locally is property taxes. And just about half of it is for your local school district or whatever your district you might be in. And if we would increase the mill levy that the schools are decreasing the mill levy that the schools have, we would probably save about half the taxes that you're paying on property taxes. The second thing that you got to think about is roads here in Sussman County. I don't know how many times it's been on the ballot, but we've always voted it down. But we need some extra money here in Sussman County for our roads. Now most of the extra money is going to Western North Dakota for roads for the oil fields and so on. But I would say those two things are probably the most important.
Thank you. That was Lyle Hansen. Next answer is Ken Hall. Ken?
Thank you, Chris. Our first priority should be one-time expenditures for infrastructure. It's probably not going to be able to all be fixed in one biennium, so we might have to do that for more than one session. The roads are big problems across the county and the state, especially in the west, Stutzman County, they're not much better. So my second priority would be education, probably increase the share of the state pays for K through 12 education. And then third, if we do that with education, it would also free up some county and township funds for infrastructure. Third, we should look to our future. And fourth, we need to return some of that money to the people that pay it in, the taxpayers.
Thank you. That was Ken Hall. And he was the last to answer that particular question. So now we're going to move on to another question that's sort of a follow-up to what you've all been saying, and it was called in by someone earlier today. With all the attention that's being paid to the western part of North Dakota with the oil boom, how will you keep District 12 area from being forgotten as far as infrastructure and all the other services are concerned? And we're going to start with you, Bernie, on that question.
Well, I think part of it is going to be, I guess in a sense I've already anticipated that being a concern, and I've already been working at establishing relationships with the Lieutenant Governor and several of the senators to make sure that they understand that Jamestown exists. And you know, obviously Dave Nething was in this position for many, many years, and just to acquaint them with the issues that we have going on in Jamestown, and they're very fully aware of them. And so I think we should be able to keep it on the table.
Thank you. That was Bernie Satram. Next to answer that question is going to be Jessica Hake. Jessica?
Wonderful. I think the most important thing to do is to build relationships with people who are already there. Through my work at North Dakota Farmers Union, I have built relationships with lots and lots of legislators from across the state. So I've seen what their needs are, and I know what our needs are. The most important thing to do is to go there, work tirelessly, be an advocate, and build relationships across the aisle, which I have done in Senator Conrad's office. So I know how to do that, and I would do that for the people of District 12.
Thank you very much, Jessica. The next person we're going to have answer that question is Ken Hall. Ken, could you tell us how we're going to make sure that District 12 isn't lost in the big picture of North Dakota?
Thank you, Chris. I think the biggest thing is to make sure that the funding formulas are fair and balanced for the whole state, even though most of the development and road construction is going on out in the western part of the state. It's pretty well known across the state that we have problems at other places too, and we just have to make sure that legislators when they pass legislation and infrastructure spending, that it's targeted to all the state, not just part of it.
Thank you, Ken. Lyle, could you answer that question now, please?
Well, I imagine schools would probably be number one. Most of our tax dollars go to the public schools, and after the election, whoever wins will meet with the school board, and a discussion will be held on what are their needs. Next to that would be the roads and bridges. We have probably more hardtop roads in North Dakota than any other county. And we need a lot of repair on those roads because they haven't been cared for lately. So those are the two, schools and roads.
Okay, next to answer the question is Alex Loyson. Alex?
Yeah, when elected, I would work hard and grow the relationships I've already made with leaders in Bismarck, whether that be the leaders of the House or the Senate, or even, you know, the Lieutenant Governor and Governor. And with that said, I think it's going to take more than just myself. So I believe, and I would strongly encourage whoever is elected to work really as a team for District 12, whether they be Democrats or Republicans. Three voices working together is going to get a lot more done than individual voices for District 12. So I would really support the team aspect of District 12 so that we can get the best representation possible.
Thank you so much, Alex. Next answer is John Grabinger.
Well, there's no question that going to Bismarck and being your state senator, they would know what the issues are in Jamestown and would hear. When I was on the city council, I was an advocate for this community wherever I could be, whether it be with the National League or the State League of Cities organization, their conference, or wherever. I was pushing for Jamestown and working tirelessly for Jamestown, and I'll do the same in the state. 4-5 years ago, I worked with two county commissioners and a few others to put together a road plan in Stutsman County here, so I'm well aware of the needs of this county, what it takes to fix them, what it's going to cost. And 4 years ago, when I ran for this same office, I supported a plan to take general fund money and put it into the DOT, the Department of Transportation, and utilize some of those funds for local counties to use. I would support enhancing that program with former Governor Hovind's leadership. Some of that money did go into the Department of Transportation for the first time, and I would support enhancing that and bringing some back.
Thank you. That was John Grabinger. Our next question, we're going to start with Ken Hall, who's over on your right, my left. And here's the question. You ready, Ken? Okay. The proposed fertilizer plant project at Spiritwood will impact the area and roads. What will you do to help the city and county? This is the largest project, I think, that North Dakota has seen.
That's what I hear. Thank you, Chris. I don't think there's a whole lot that can be done at the state level, but anything that can be done, I will be working with all the people in the area to make the development happen and bring jobs and people to the area. I support the project 100%, and I know some people are a little bit leery of it, but it's going to be good for Jamestown to see some growth after all these years. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. Next to answer is Lyle Hansen. Lyle, would you like me to say it again?
Yeah.
Okay. The proposed fertilizer plant project at Spiritwood will impact the area and roads. What will you do to help the city and county?
Well, first of all, I don't think the state can put money into a private business, but I will help out whatever they need. And as a result, probably tax breaks for 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, or whatever. That would be really the biggest thing that we could do, a tax break.
Okay, thank you very much. Next to answer the question is Alex Loyson. Alex.
Yeah, Chris, I think there needs to be a little background brought into this. This plant you're talking about will create 2,000 construction jobs, 100 to 150 full-time jobs, which probably a lot of those employees are going to reside in the community of Jamestown. And it's right around a $1.2 billion investment, the largest single private investment in North Dakota's history. This is a very, very, very exciting time. And I would hate to have things slowed up or something gone wrong because leaders weren't working from the local level to the state level, even to the federal level, and with the people in the company. So I will work with everyone from local leaders to other state leaders and federal and people in the company to ensure Jamestown can capitalize on this great opportunity.
Thank you, Alex. Next answer is John Grabinger. John.
Well, as I said in my previous answer to the last question, it's in similar, we need to get funding from the state. The only way we can is by putting some in the DOT and having it earmarked. Now, whether or not we can get it for a project like that, it's not for private, it's for the county. That goes with the whole project the county needs. And if we can help the county get some of these roads fixed and taken care of, this will just piggyback with that. Absolutely, this is a great time for our community. To bring this here is wonderful, and we've got to step up to the plate. Hopefully, working with the city and the county and the state legislature, we can do that and bring some money back that'll help this county in the long run.
Thank you. That was John Grabinger. Next will be Bernie Satrum. Bernie.
Governor Dalrymple has a proposal for infrastructure not only out west, but also money that can be used out east. And it's critical that I think we're going to have a critical need. I'm very concerned about old Highway 10, that gets fixed so that people will move to Jamestown rather than deciding to take the interstate and go to Valley City instead. In addition to that, we have another issue which is very critical, not just the infrastructure regarding that plant, but also the housing for all these people and the growth. Right now, I would say that the vacancy rate, actually I talked to one of the big rental companies, they said the vacancy rate is about zero, and my own experience is that. And so we really don't have the proper housing, adequate housing to handle the influx, and obviously Katie Anderson and I think the City Council are starting to think about that as well as the County Commissioners. But we have, it's a big project and we need to get on it.
Thank you, Bernie. Last answer is Jessica Haig. Jessica.
What a great opportunity for Stutzman County to have something like this come into the county right here and produce these wonderful jobs. I work at North Dakota Farmers Union and they were key in implementing this fertilizer plant to be right here. So what I would do, what I would propose is the biggest thing we can do is we need to sit down with local leaders, with county leaders, and we need to figure out what the needs are. Not only are we going to have infrastructure needs in the county, we're going to have housing needs, and we need to ensure that our local law enforcement has the resources that they need to take care of the safety and security of our citizens. So I think the best thing we can do is sit down, open up, have a conversation, and figure out what needs we have bringing this plant in so that we can create a wonderful, be proactive in Stutzman County rather than reactive.
Thank you, Jessica. First to answer the next question is going to be Alex Loyson. Are you ready, Alex?
Yep.
We've been talking a lot about the western part of the state, mm-hmm. and the Keystone Pipeline expansion project and fracking have become very political issues, not just for our state, but for the entire country.
Yep.
Can you tell me how you feel about those issues?
Yeah, I tell you what, I think President Obama had a very, very big mistake in not supporting the Keystone Pipeline. The other thing with this fracking is the main concern I hear out there is about our groundwater and our water supply. Now that's a couple hundred feet down. The oil they're drilling out is close to a little over a mile down, and it's in casing and steel piping and cement. So it is safe. North Dakota actually exceeds all the EPA regulations, which is great. So that shows what we're doing as a state. And I guess my fear, quickly, is the EPA stepping in and doing something ridiculous, kind of like when they were trying to regulate dust for farmers on gravel roads. I mean, come on. Or methane gas coming out of the back of cows. That's just ridiculous. We need to make sure that we have common sense regulations to ensure that oil development continues.
Thank you, Alex. Jessica, would you like me to repeat the question?
Yes, please.
Okay. The Keystone Pipeline expansion project and fracking have become very political issues, not just in North Dakota, but for our entire country. How do you feel about them?
Well, I feel President Obama made a large mistake in not building the Keystone Pipeline. I think that would have been a great opportunity and a great creator of jobs right here in North Dakota. As for fracking, I think out in western North Dakota, we're doing a great job of building the energy boom and being blessed with the resources that we have while preserving the quaint way of life, the quality of life that we enjoy right here in North Dakota. I've been out there 5 times this year to Williston and back, and I've seen that some of the new technologies that they have are allowing for us to preserve our quality of life while advancing the energy boom. On some of those pads where they have the oil rigs going, they can put up to 12 rigs on one pad now and going in all different directions. So I think we're doing a great job of advancing our technologies, preserving the wonderful quality of life we have here, and allowing for the creation of jobs right here in North Dakota.
Thank you, Jessica. Next answer will be Bernie Satram.
I think some of the others have said it very well. I think that Obama certainly had misplaced alliances or something in his decisions and some of his thoughts. And I particularly agree with Alex's thoughts regarding the EPA being out of line. And we as North Dakotans love our land, and we are not going to want to destroy it for future generations. And so I think, I believe in local control and being willing to tell the EPA that they do not belong in our business. We should be, we have, North Dakota regulates the environment very well, and I think we need to keep it that way.
Thank you, Bernie. Next is Lyle Hansen. Lyle.
The Keystone pipeline probably was moved because of the Ogallala water field in Nebraska, and I think they've worked that out, so they've gone around that. As far as fracking is concerned, last session we had a bill in to find out exactly what they're doing and what they're putting down there and what materials they're using, and they wouldn't put it up or put it in into law. But since April 1st, new regulations on fracking has been put in, and now it's pretty well taken care of. So when we drill for oil in the new oil fields, they go down two miles and then 2 miles to the right or to the left. It's a new way of drilling for oil, and it's deep enough so it doesn't bother our water table here.
Thank you very much, Lyle. Next to answer the question is Ken Hall. Ken?
Thank you, Chris. The Keystone Pipeline would have been a much better, safer, environmentally friendly way to transport the oil rather than by train or truck. So it was a big mistake to delay it or whatever happened to it. It's still not going. Parts of it are being built way down in Texas, I think, but nothing up here, up north. As far as fracking, I guess it's been going on for a lot of years already. They've done a lot of improvements to it, and it's been proven environmentally safe. There's been no contaminated water wells that have been proved to be contaminated by fracking. And I think right now it's a pretty safe way to recover the oil. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. The last answer is John Grabinger.
As far as the Keystone Pipeline, yeah, I wish that would have went through. Hopefully they'll get that worked out like Representative Hansen was saying that he thinks they maybe have. I hope that can be completed and done. And also, as far as the fracking, the regulations have now gone into effect. The oil companies and drillers are working hard. They're meeting the regulations and requirements out there. And if they continue to do that, this is great. So,
thank you, John. I think everybody answered that question. We'll move on to the next one. We're going to start with Jessica Hake. Jessica, are you ready?
Yes, ma'am.
This was called in by one of our viewers. Do you think North Dakota should establish a nonpartisan ethics committee to hold legislators and statewide office holders more accountable?
I think that would be a step in the right direction. The Center for Public Integrity recently did a study, and they released it in July of this past year, and we received an F as a rating for a state legislator. Now, there have been specific examples of this sort of thing going on. We have a legislator from Minot who sits on the tax committee who hasn't paid her taxes for years and various other things. So I think it would go to the integrity of our legislators as well as our statewide candidates to put something like this together. I would be for that.
Thank you, Jessica. Next to answer is Bernie Satram. Bernie.
Some weeks ago, I was in a meeting with John Grabinger, and he mentioned that North Dakota is the seventh most corrupt state in the union. And so I did a little research, and part of my blood started to kind of get revved up when I heard that. And I did check the study, and what they do in their rating is primarily based on the levels of bureaucracy. As far as accountability is important, and a lot of states are full-time legislative people that are basically moved to the capital, and they live their lives there. In North Dakota, we go for 80 days every 2 years, and basically we have our neighbors to be accountable to. It's interesting to me that the same study that says that North Dakota is the seventh most corrupt says that New Jersey is the most transparent and least corrupt. I think that thing is bogus.
Thank you, Bernie. Next answer will be Lyle Hansen. Lyle.
I'll give you an example why we should have it. I think it was two years ago or 4 years ago, a person running for the House of Representatives was picked up for DUI, tipped his car over and wrecked it, tried to bribe the highway patrolman, yet he was elected in the fall election. That's why we should have it.
Thank you, Lyle. Next to answer will be Ken Hall. Ken?
Yes, thank you, Chris. I'm against an ethics committee. I think it's just another layer of bureaucracy. The best way to handle ethics is to make sure that ethical people are in charge. That's what's been going on in North Dakota for years and years. I don't think we've had any big problems. There may have been many small ones, but we've not had any big problems that would justify another bureaucracy in the state. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. Next to answer is John Grabinger.
I did bring this up in the AAUW forum, and I do believe that we need an ethics committee in North Dakota, and I would wholeheartedly support it. With some of the things that are happened, you know, by our legislators, by our department heads and so forth, there's no question that there needs to be some kind of watch system to make sure that the transparency is there. And this is the reason why we ended up in this study in the first place, is because the transparency is low in North Dakota. It's not clean, and this story was carried by the Fox Business Channel, the Fair and Balanced Network. And so it's surprising to me. He even said that it was in there, that we are the seventh most corrupt state in the union, and I'm not proud of that. And I also was informed that the comment about New Jersey was retracted in July. So with that, I do support an ethics committee. I hope we can get that done in the next legislative session.
Thank you, John. Alex.
Well, I tell you what, there are things that I like about this and things that I don't like. A couple of the things that I do like are holding people accountable. I believe if you screw up, you need to be held accountable to the fullest extent. Another thing I do like is the bipartisan support idea. I would love to have more bipartisan support. It's a good thing to have in North Dakota. Now the things that I worry about are, do we really need another government program or government entity watching us? You know, I believe, as Ken had stated, the best thing is to elect ethical people, and that's why we're here at this forum, so that people can realize the type of people we are, and hopefully we'll elect ethical people. And if not, we're going to have to live with our unethical decisions for the next 2 years after our session is over. So we really do need to hold people accountable, but we got to be careful at which way we do it.
Thank you, Alex. Everybody got that question right? Okay. So I didn't mean you got the question right, like correct. You know, that's not what I was talking about, but you all got to answer it. Okay. Next, we're going to start, Lyle, we're going to start with you, and it has to do with education, which is right up your alley. It's going to be two questions combined on either end of the spectrum. The first is, what will you do for early childhood education in North Dakota? And the second part is, what would you do specifically to make college more affordable for students who got through kindergarten? At the other end of the spectrum.
I didn't get to go through kindergarten.
Okay.
So. Anyway, I would support, like I have in the past, kindergarten and preschool. We don't have preschool in this school district, but I would support that. A lot of people use that as a babysitter type of thing, and it probably would help our enrollment. And as far, what was the last part?
Oh, what would you do to make college affordable for working families?
First thing, I would change the Bank of North Dakota interest rates. They charge students 6 to 8% on a student loan, whereas you can buy a house or a car or a bicycle or a motorcycle at about 1.5% or something like that. But I would lower the rate for student loans, and this would help out. And because college costs now about $22,000 to $30,000 a year, those are things that I would do.
Thank you very much. That was Lyle Hansen. Now we're going to go to Ken Hall. Ken, did you want me to repeat the questions?
Please.
Okay. What would you do for early childhood education in North Dakota? And what would you do to make college more affordable for students of working families?
As far as the early childhood education, I think that most of that should be done at home. It's been proven. There's a study that just came out last year, the year before, on Head Start. That's a 50-year program, and it's basically a failure. It hasn't advanced our kids at all. That should be the main thing that we're looking at, is education for our children. And they say that any benefits gained in Head Start are lost by the first grade. So that's money wasted as far as I'm concerned, and it's money that could be better spent on other education. As far as higher education, I think there are a lot of incentives in place for students, grants and scholarships and work programs. I went through two different stages of going to college myself. I worked full-time while I went to college full-time, so I know it can be done. Thank you. I'm also for reducing the interest rate a little bit on the student loan, if we can.
By the state of North Dakota?
By the Bank of North Dakota.
Okay, yep. Thank you, Ken.
Thank you.
Next answer will be John Grabinger.
Well, I have to disagree. I believe in early childhood education. In fact, when I was president of the St. John's Academy School Board, we were the first school in the city to take on all-day kindergarten. I felt it was important. We did it with our limited budgets, and we made it work. I support early childhood education. I would do that in the legislature as well. As far as college costs for our students, I think there's several things we can do. If the tuitions need to be raised at our state colleges and universities, there's a possibility of using the state student assistance fund, the state student loan assistance fund. There's nearly $40 million in that, and that could be used to offset some of those tuition increases. I also support the lowering of the interest rates. And also, there's a proposal coming from, I believe it was a representative or senator from Fargo, suggesting that we raise the student scholarship program from the state. And I would like to, rather than raise that, enhance that so more students could take advantage of that program.
Thank you, John. Next to answer the question is Alex Loyson. Alex?
Yeah, as far as early childhood care or childhood education goes, I really think we need to take a look at every option and really focus on what's best for the children. Now, if it proves to be that a Head Start program or something like that is the best option, then we go that route. But I don't believe in you know, per se, forcing someone's child to go into a program that they necessarily don't want to or their parents don't want them to. So we got to be careful and respect the families in that aspect. As far as college, hey, I'm all for making it more affordable. A couple of the things I would love to see happen are, well, first of all, to back up, in college nowadays, there are obviously 2 and 4 year colleges. Now, the 2 year programs are just as important as these 4 year programs. So we got to keep that in mind. So part of a proposal that I would put forward is to possibly tie the merit-based scholarships, not necessarily into science or English if someone's going to be a carpenter or an electrician. Well, then let's find a way to tie it into to courses that they take that will prove, you know, them to be successful in that degree. So that would really help 2 year students being able to qualify for these merit-based scholarships. And other than that, I think I would be open to taking a look at the interest rate of the Bank of North Dakota, but I think we should really focus on merit-based scholarships for everyone that qualifies.
Thank you, Alex.
Yep.
Jessica.
Thank you. I support early childhood education. Right now in North Dakota, we have 985 students on the waiting list for Head Start, 40 to 50 right here in Stutsman County. We're one of only 10 states that does not help fund Head Start, and that is where you develop skills such as focusing, learning how to comprehend things, and learning how to sit down and learn things. So I would fully support something like that. As far as higher education goes, I'm paying off student loans right now, so of course I would be all for lowering those interest rates, as well as the $40 million out of the student loan trust funds to address the rising tuition costs, as well as expanding that merit scholarship program that they were talking about to include average students so that we can keep students right here in North Dakota and they can either go to vocational schools or four-year degrees, because right now in Western North Dakota we need lots of trades, but we also need to keep people going to our four-year colleges so we have the professionals as well. So that would sort of be my plan. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, Bernie.
I think we all love children. And obviously, we want to all give all children a head start, if that's possible. And my concern is that right now, the Head Start program costs about twice as much as a private preschool. And some of them are in this town. They're excellent. So I'd love to see some sort of a voucher situation where they could actually take that money and utilize it in that way, if that would be their choice. Albert Einstein said something very interesting. He said, if you want to raise brilliant children, read them lots of fairy tales. And if you want to raise really brilliant children, read them even more fairy tales. And I think the key is that the importance of spending time with our children. The parents are an incredibly critical element in all of this. We should not be giving that responsibility or pushing that responsibility on the government or on the schools. It belongs with us. The second issue is, I'm hoping, one of the things is that our parents, the mothers are spending, a lot of our mothers have two jobs and three jobs. And so I'm hoping that they can get economy, they get better pay, and they'll have the option of spending more time with their children, which is an incredibly valuable time. I would love to see some interest rate reduction. I'd love to see some dual credits as much as possible while people are in high school. The other thing that's really critical is that we I guess my time's up, but that's critical is that we don't spend a lot of money and get into a huge amount of debt for a degree that's not marketable. And so we need to encourage that as well. If you owe a big student loan, but you're making big bucks, it's okay. If you have a student loan and you don't have a job, then it's a tragedy.
Thank you very much, Bernie. I'm going to open this question for anybody who wants to answer it. Are you ready? Just raise your hand if you want to answer. What is your view of the states maintaining hunting opportunities with the loss of CRP lands? Anybody? Hunters? Go, John.
We just addressed this in the newspaper the other day, the same question. And the critical thing here is, as we know, the CRP program is going out with the agricultural land being taken back and the farm program not being passed. So it's critical that the state work and try and increase their efforts in the plots program, and where that opens public private land for public hunting. And I think that's the key and about the most essential thing the state can do at this point.
Anybody have a different view on that? Your views, Bernie, go ahead.
Well, I agree with a lot of what John said, and I think in addition to that, we can really be, I think as sportsmen, we really need to be good stewards of the opportunity that we have, and we need to be, I think courtesy goes a long way in opening those hunting opportunities for us. So I think that's going to be critical as hunters, that we establish relationships with the landowners and are courteous hunters and respectful, and I think that's going to be a big part of having land open to us.
Thank you. And thank you all for calling in your questions. I didn't get to all of them, and I'm sorry. We had a couple that were emailed in, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to give these questions to them. Some of you have email addresses, and perhaps they'll answer you privately. What I'd like to do now is we're going to start with the closing remarks so that we won't get bumped up against time here. And I'm going to start with Alex Loyson. Alex.
Awesome. This election is about our future. My vision is one of more freedom, common sense legislation, continued economic prosperity, and lower taxes and an increase in quality of life for all residents. With the right leadership, Jamestown and North Dakota's future can be even brighter. When elected, I will bring fresh ideas, positive energy, and common sense leadership to Bismarck for the residents of District 12. I will work with all leaders in the legislature both Democrats and Republicans, so Jamestown residents have fair representation. I believe our representatives should be easy to access. That is why I have given you my personal cell phone number on the campaign trail. If you have any ideas or questions, please feel free to contact me at any time. My number is 701-269-9482. Again, my name is Alex Loyson, and I respectfully ask for your vote and for the opportunity to serve you and your as your District 12 representative in the North Dakota House. I promise I'll work hard for you. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Alex Loyson running in District 12 as the Republican for state representative. We're now going to go to Jessica Haig. Jessica.
Thank you, Chris, and thank you, CSI, for hosting this wonderful forum. As you've heard tonight, there are many ideas on the table, but I can promise you one thing. I will go to Bismarck and work tirelessly and hard every day for the citizens of District 12. Through my volunteer efforts in Meals on Wheels with Safe Shelter and being a coach for the Special Olympics, I have had the privilege of working with people from a wide variety of life. In my professional career at North Dakota Farmers Union, I've had hands-on experience working with all of these issues and traveling across the state to see what the issues are, as well as being a community leader right here in Jamestown. I will work hard for you. I love this town. I love being in this town, and I love working for this town. So I respectfully ask for your vote on November 6th, because when I go to the legislature, I will take my bipartisan experience and work with Republicans and Democrats alike to find sound, real solutions for District 12.
Thank you, Jessica. Next, to give us your closing statement, is Ken Hall. Ken.
Thank you, Chris. when you choose me for your legislator in the House, I will work hard to get the job done for Jamestown and North Dakota. I will listen to you and keep you informed of pending legislation. In order for me to be a good legislator, you will also need to be part of keeping, do your part in keeping yourself informed and advising me of your opinions on legislative matters. Good government is only achieved when most people participate. My contact information is on all my handout literature. The incumbent in this race has voted against tax relief at almost every opportunity, and I would expect that his running mates will do the same. I will look at all aspects of legislation and then find a balance that is fair to everyone. I will fight to keep control at the closest level to the people and not centralize it in Washington as has been being done lately. Thank you for your time and to listen, and I would appreciate your vote and support and input. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Ken Hall running from District 12 on the Republican side. Now the Democrat side. Lyle Hansen, could you give us your closing remarks, please?
It's been my privilege to serve the people of District 12. I want to remind the voters of District 12 that the upcoming election is not about the candidates, it's about the state that we are privileged to live in. It's about the citizens of District 12 and the challenges that we face to make our state and national nation a better place to live. I ask for your vote on November 6th, so thank you very much.
Thank you, that was Lyle Hansen. Now we're going to go to the Senate candidates for District 12, Republican Bernie Satram. Bernie.
About 8 months ago, I started a campaign. It's been exciting, it's been fun. I've met hundreds of you. Many of you are now friends. We have a great opportunity ahead of us. And one of the questions I guess I would ask is, what kind of vision do you have for your future? And my concern is that we have a great vision, that we work together, that we build our education, that we build opportunities, that we keep common sense regulations, that we lower the taxes, that we don't force people out of their home because of high property tax. And I would appreciate your support. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Bernie Satram. And last, and certainly not least, is John Grabinger, who is running as the Democrat for District 12 Senate. Thank you.
Thank you again, Chris, and thank you folks for tuning in this evening. As we enter the last 2 weeks of this campaign, I'm reminded of just how important the decisions we will make in this election will affect our daily lives. Although I know and understand how tired many of you are with the relentless campaign rhetoric, we must remember that this is part of the greatest government in the world. The candidates before you have all offered themselves for public service, and it is now up to you to decide who will best represent you in the state legislature. I believe that the voters should consider the background and experience of each candidate. This hopefully brings to light any one-issue candidates or those who have aligned themselves with any fringe political groups. This will in turn ensure that the most qualified person will be elected to represent you. I feel with my years of serving this community as an elected leader, small business owner, civic volunteer, and on countless committees, I offer the leadership that this community needs. Whomever wins this seat must be willing to cross the aisle and at times go against party politics to best serve the needs of District 12. If they're going to fill the seat of our long-term Senator Dave Nething, folks, I don't want to just win this seat. I want to fill this seat if I'm elected. I'd ask for your vote on November 6th for John Grabinger. Thank you.
Thank you, John, and thank all of you for watching. Please stay tuned. We're going to the County Commission candidates next. I just want to remind you, you can call in your questions for that. And a couple of these questions that I'm actually holding over that seem more appropriate for the County Commission. Thank you for watching, and I'd like to tell you we're going to have a little break now so we can reset with the County Commission. We'll be right back. Thank you all for coming.
Watch replays of Meet Your Candidates, the award-winning voter information TV series on CSI TV 10, the replay channel. Join the CSI News Now team, election night, Tuesday, November 6th, for City Matters Live at 7 p.m. and local election returns at 8. Tuesday, November 6th, City Matters and election returns. CSI TV 10, the replay channel, your election source.